is a reading from Dr. King's collection of sermons, Strength to Love. It's chapter 2, Transformed Nonconformist. These are excerpts. This command to not conform comes not only from Paul, but also from our Lord and Master Jesus Christ, the world's most dedicated nonconformist, whose ethical nonconformity still challenges the conscience of mankind, of humankind. When an affluent society would coax us to believe that happiness consists of the size of our automobiles or the impressiveness of our houses and the expensiveness of our clothes, and I would add, or maybe a $500 million yacht with a companion tender with a helipad, Jesus reminds us a person's life consists not in the abundance of the things which they possess. When we, through compassionless detachment and arrogant individualism, fail to respond to the needs of the underprivileged, the Master says, "Inasmuch as you have done to the least of these, my siblings, you have done to me." When we allow the spark of revenge in our souls to flame up in hate towards our enemies, Jesus teaches, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for them who despitefully use you and persecute you. Everywhere and at all times, the love ethic of Jesus is a radiant light revealing ugliness of our stale conformity. Here ends the reading. June will come, and when I am back in the pulpit, I will not be trying to tell jokes at the beginning of the sermon. In fact, this week I could only find one joke about nonconformists, maybe two. The rest are just pithy commentary, but worth your consideration. Suspend your need for a punchline until we get to the end. Pithy comment number one. This is from Mark Twain. Whenever you find yourself on the side of the majority, it is time to pause and reflect. Two. Conforming saves us from the painful job of thinking. Three, this is from Dr. Seuss. Be who you are and say what you feel, because those who mind don't matter and those who matter don't mind. Four, you don't get harmony when everyone sings one note. Five, you can always tell a nonconformist because they look like all the other nonconformists. And six, if there's anything the nonconformist hates worse than a conformist, it's another nonconformist who doesn't conform to the prevailing standards of nonconformity. Onward. I remember when I was a kid and I first heard the term nonconformist. It was put to me by my brother Scott, who emphasized its positive, rebellious, and glorious overtones. It's when we don't do things that everyone else does just because everyone else does them. This had to be about 1962 or 63. I was 7 or 8. We were just coming out of the 50s, and in retrospect, it seemed that things were opening up, and conformity was a powerful concept in the 50s. The 1950s were famous for casting people in conformist roles, especially for white people. We came out of World War II, where people adopted military discipline, and came out of the war in the confinement of a patriarchal structure. The man in the gray flannel suit did what he was told. The wifey stayed home and raised the baby boom and did what her husband told her to do. A man's home was his castle. Then the beat poets came, snapping their fingers and living their art. And Elvis showed up, singing and moving like a black person. Dylan was making songs that were unlike the happy pop tune love songs of like the Everly Brothers, who would sing Wake Up Little Susie. When Dylan showed up on the charts, a big part of his appeal was being a nonconformist. The Beatles showed up and did not look like anything anyone had ever seen. The Rolling Stones followed both Elvis and the Beatles by doing black music with the adventurous sense of experimentation that came in with the Beatles. It was cool because it was different. This nonconformity was the source of new ideas and a signpost of what was to come. When the civil rights movement started to take hold, black people were called communists because they were bucking the system. Their nonviolent protests were copied by those against the American war in Vietnam, and they were very much tarred with the same communist brush. The idea of the nonconformist marked a change in our secure little world. My dad and mom were conformists, but they thought in nonconformity when they got home. My dad worked for Dayton's for 30 years. My mom taught school for 20 years. But they were educated enough to challenge ideas and the thoughts that came out. They were pro-civil rights. They were anti-war. Now, many people date the emergence of the modern civil rights movement to when Emmett Till was killed in 1955. The same year that Elvis broke out. In 1962, when Dylan was surfacing, James Meredith was allowed to enter Ole Miss, which the governor of Mississippi attempted to thwart. Because as he said, we will not drink from the cup of genocide. Then as now, there are white people who think that progress for black people means that they're gonna lose something. The Beatles showed up to console us after Kennedy was murdered and lead us into the nonconformist era of long hair and a deeper involvement in the electric guitar. So now we see a kind of cultural counterpoint. The big historical events responded to with advances in cultural flowering. The times they were a changing. The church has been riven with the question of cultural conformity as far back as it goes. There were church people on either side of the divide of culture and the counterculture. John the Baptist, thought of as the teacher of Jesus, took the worship of God out of the temple and into the wilderness. Jesus took the teaching of the Bible and the interpreting of the Bible away from the monopoly of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. The Jewish Christians separated from the Jewish establishment through Peter and Paul. Then the Western Roman Church broke away from the Eastern Greek Orthodox Church. Then the Protestants broke off from the Catholics. Even as late as 2012, we see schismatic behavior when the Covenant Order of Evangelical Presbyterians, also known as ECHO or Evangelical Covenant Order, broke off from the Presbyterian Church USA to avoid ordaining and marrying the LGBTQIA+. So it is part of our heritage to be nonconformists. I bring all this up in the context of the bloodbath happening in Israel and Palestine, and how do we respond? Our denomination does not issue a blank check to Israel to cash as it sees fit. Our commitment is to both sides, which is, of course, impossible. This is from the PCUSA mission page. Quote, since 1948, Presbyterian General Assemblies have repeatedly addressed the Middle East and particularly Israel and Palestine. The Presbyterian position has consistently been to affirm the right of Israel to exist as a sovereign state within secure internationally recognized borders, and the right of the Palestinians to self-determination, including the right to an establishment of a neighboring, independent, sovereign state toward the end of establishing a just and durable peace, end quote. Aspirational. This conflict itself goes back to the British. It is a land twice promised. The British promised the Arabs their own nations if they helped overthrow the Ottoman Turks. Lawrence of Arabia is portrayed in the film of the same name as someone who is trying to help the Arabs get their own nations, self-determination. But in reality, he helped dupe the Arabs into fighting the Turks and then losing the Middle East to Britain, who wanted access to the oil. They also promised the land to the European Jewish community in 1917. The Balfour Declaration promised open immigration to Palestine for the Jewish community, for a homeland, in a series of negotiations that had neither Palestinian nor Turkish representatives. But it wasn't to come in time. In 1939, as the Jews were being rounded up by the Nazis in Europe, Britain banned further Jewish immigration to Palestine right when they needed it the most. No one wanted the Jewish refugees before or after World War II. The US turned away boatloads of Jewish refugees in 1939, sending them back to Germany for immediate disembarkation into the concentration camps. After World War II, Jews started moving to Israel legally and illegally. The Brits tried to keep them out. The Haganah, the roots of the Israeli army, turned to sabotage activities against the British authorities, including bombing bridges, rail lines, and ships used to deport illegal Jewish immigrants, as well as assisting in bringing Jews to Palestine in defiance of British policy, smuggling them in. The King David Hotel bombing was a terrorist attack carried out on July 22, 1946, by the militant right-wing Zionist underground organization called the Irgun, Jewish terrorists. The hotel was the British administrative headquarters for Palestine, which was housed in the southern wing of the hotel in Jerusalem during the Jewish insurgency. 91 people were killed of various nationalities, and 46 were injured. British resistance to a Jewish state began to falter. In 1948, a partition of Palestine was declared by the UN. The Arab community was not included in the conversation, and they fought back. War broke out, and it has been war ever since. As many as 1.25 million Palestinians were made refugees by the founding of the Jewish State of Israel. When I was a kid, I wondered how a war could go on for 7 years or 100 years. The 100 years war? Now we know. It's been 20 years in Afghanistan. It's been 78 years in Israel. My time with Christian Palestinians does not simplify or clarify my picture of what needs to happen there. They told me the Israeli guns do not see a difference between Muslims and Christian Palestinians. The Christian Palestinians have been there since Jesus and have not been part of the Palestinian terrorist effort. But the Jewish refugees turned Palestine into a land of Palestinian refugees. The Muslim community sees the European Jews as a crusader state, created to put a European nation in the Middle East, a foothold that can be used when the West needs it. We saw an example of that when on June 7th, 1981, Israel served as the American cat's paw and bombed a nuclear power plant, the reactors built by the French for Saddam Hussein. They were too close to building an atomic bomb. It would be hard for the US to go in and bomb it, so Israel did it. There's nothing simple about this situation. There is no easy solution. Israel has a power vacuum right now because Netanyahu cannot form a government, but neither can his opposition. By pulling out the stops on retaliation now, Netanyahu may have undermined the participation of the Arab Israelis, were partnering with the left-wing peace parties. The heating up of hostilities only benefits the extremists on both sides. Not only that, it is awkward for us to criticize Israel as Americans. How can we criticize what Israel does with Palestinians after what we've done to the Native Americans? How can we criticize Israel's human rights record when we have such an abysmal track record with how we treat Black Americans? How can we talk about cultural racism when Asian Americans are getting beat up all the time? How can we talk about Israeli police beating up Palestinian youth when our own police kill young Black men all the time? It is hard to find action we can take, and our inclination as Americans is to try to fix everything as soon as possible. Our church tries to take action where it can. The PCUSA disinvested from the Caterpillar Corporation when one of their heavily armored tractors was used to run over and kill an American protester, Rachel Corrie. She was trying to prevent them from destroying Palestinian housing and just ran over her. That was in 2003, and it was one more division in the church that led to the Echo Schism. Presbyterians who wanted to support Israel and who knew how profitable Caterpillar was saw this as irrational and even anti-Semitic. We are going to see more division over this moving forward. Muslim and Palestinian congresspeople in the United States are naturally finding a home within the Democratic Party, and they're speaking out about having a more balanced approach to Palestinians. Even Bernie Sanders, the Jewish senator of Vermont, is saying that we've been ignoring the Palestinian side of the story for far too long. And he's right. Republicans, however, have a big constituency of evangelical Christians. They are pro-Israel for many reasons, but one of them is a bit creepy. They want Israel to be there so that they can rebuild the temple so that the second coming can be inaugurated. They need a great war to break out there, which will lead to the return of Jesus and the massacre of everyone who does not believe him as the Messiah. That is the atheists, the Muslims, and the Jews. This is why I was not allowed in the Al-Aqsa Mosque, the one with the famous gold dome. Because Christians had gone in there before and tried to start fights with Muslims to bring about the second coming and the return of Jesus. That's one more piece of Christian crack pottery. But there's more. When I was on the Temple Mount, our guide, Lazarus Kervorkian, told us to watch the various groups of Israeli police. There were groups of two and three, male and female, machine guns and pistols. Then a bunch of them started collecting around a group of black-clad women led by two men. They were Jewish, and they were what is referred to as settlers, Jewish radicals who want all Arabs out of Palestine because they believe that only Jews belong there. They are not allowed to gather in prayer on the Temple Mount. That's an old rule that has been there a long time. Hundreds of years. The Temple Mount is managed by a Jordanian charity that supervises care of the site. But enforcement of the rules for Jewish people has to be done by Jewish police, heavily armed, because the settlers are trying to start a fight. So, there are extremists on all three sides. There are sane people on all three sides. All three sides are innocent. All three sides are guilty. The Jews did not choose to be slaughtered by the millions by the Nazis, who were culturally and practically Christians. The Palestinians did not choose to be living in a place that would be claimed by a refugee nation, the Israelis, who are culturally and practically Jewish. The Palestinian Christians did not choose to be caught in the two jaws of a pair of pliers blamed by the Jews for being Palestinians and by the Arabs for being Christians. And it was their cousins in Lebanon, the Falange Christians, who massacred between 450 and 600 Palestinian civilians in the Sabra and Shatila camps. My uncle Lauren was one of two reporters who broke the story of that massacre. The Falange did it under the watchful eye of the Israeli army. Reverend Mitri Rahab, the Palestinian Lutheran that hosted our trip, reminds us in the book, Faith in the Face of Empire, that, quote, the land has been occupied by the Assyrians, 722 BCE, the Babylonians, 587 BCE, the Persians, 538 BCE, the Greeks, 333 BCE, the Romans, 63 BCE, the Byzantines, 426, the Arabs, 637, the Tartars, 1040, the Mamluks, 1291, the Mongols, 1401, the Ottomans, 1516, the British, 1917, and the Israelis since 1948, to name just a few of the main occupiers, end quote. Before that, there were Egyptians, Scythians, the Sea People, who knows what else. I feel sometimes that my role is to somehow render some judgment upon situations and speak up about what I have found. But Israel-Palestine is vexing. I feel like I am bound to advocate for all three sides. All three deserve a place to live. All three have experienced immeasurable loss. All three are suffering now. They will say that we have to pick a side. I don't think I can. I think I have to try and pick all three sides and advocate for all three of them and watch their suffering, witness their suffering, and not turn away. There is a danger there, though. We have to pay attention to the fact that these flare-ups of violence lead our own crackpots to become violent too. Anti-Semitic violence is up in the US and in the UK. Anti-Muslim violence is stimulated by this as well. We cannot be advocates of violence, even though our culture is based on endless and repetitive violence. We cannot advocate for revenge because revenge is endless, even though our culture is based on narratives that are unfailingly based on revenge and vengeful fantasies. We have to speak up against it. We cannot conform to a culture of violence. We have to be nonconformists. When we allow the spark of revenge in our souls to flame up in hate towards our enemies, Jesus, the nonconformist, teaches us, love your enemies. That has to be us. Israel and Palestine are far away, but revenge and hate are right here. Let us pray. Dear God, we watch from a distance, aghast with the images of rockets taking out neighborhoods and reports of civilian deaths, especially of children. We pray for peace where there is no peace. We pray for love where there is no love. We pray that you will take this in your hands and make something work someday. All this we ask in your name. Amen.
I took this video of Oak Creek, south of Flagstaff, Arizona, on the way to Sedona along State Highway 89A.